Good morning, everyone. Today, Dr. Abichal will give us the last talk about the chapter of the neuroradiology in the core radiology textbook. Please.
Good morning. Thank you for being here. Today, we talk about spine tumor and degenerative spine. We have to localize the spinal lesion into intramedullary, intradural, extramedullary, and extradural. Intramedullary means within the substan of the cord. It causes expansion of the cord and reduces CSF space. The most important here, we have astrocytoma and ependymoma, which make up to 95% of all intramedullary lesions. The other less than 5% will be hemangioblastoma, demyelinating lesion, syringes, rarely arteriovenous malformation of the cord, rarely metastasis and abscess of the cord. Intradural, extramedullary, it means within the dura outside the cord. The lesion will form an acute angle with the CSF and compress the cord while widens the CSF space. The mouse is not working. Nerve sheath tumors, schwannoma and neurofibroma and meningioma make up 90% of intradural extramedullary lesions. And we have the other like mixopapillary ependymoma, dermoid, epidermoid, arachnoiditis. These lesions, epidermoid, dermoid, may also occur extradurally, but rarely. Extradural means outside the dura. It will compress the CSF on the cord and form an obtuse angle with the CSF. The lesion will form an obtuse angle. Yes. The most important of differential diagnosis of extradural lesions, we have degenerative disease, including herniated disc, osteophyte, the other one, vertebral neoplasm, epidural metastasis, hemangioma, epidural lipomatosis, that we talk about of them. Intramedullary lesion, astrocytoma first, is the most common intramedullary tumor in children, make up 30%. Most are low grade, while rarely less than 2% high grade glioblastoma multiforme may occur. It involves several segments, several vertebral body levels that cause fusiform dilatation of the spinal cord. Cystic components are seen in approximately 1/3, and a shrink may be present. Almost always enhanced, and hemorrhage is rare in compared to ependymoma. Sagittal T2 weighted image reveals an expansion of the cord, of the cervical and upper thoracic, and diffuse hyperintensity. Sagittal and axial port contrast T1 weighted image demonstrate an enhancing mass within the cord, extending from C7 to T3 with cystic cavity.
So it's an enhancing, no hemorrhage, intramedullary, over several segments.
Yes,
cystic component. However, it's very difficult to differentiate
from ependymoma. Yes,
so it's
even impossible. Understand. Ependymoma is the most common intramedullary tumor in adults, about 60%, associated with neurofibromatosis type 2, especially in children, and it's hemorrhagic, causes complex MRI appearance, peripheral hemostrin deposition, dark rim on T2, and blooming artifacts. Most ependymoma also enhance. Classically, there is extensive formation of both tumoral cysts and non-tumoral polar cysts. Or a classical radiographic finding is scalloping of the vertebral body, while it's rare because it will be seen in the advanced stage. Here, the hemorrhage is more common, while in astrocytoma, it's less common. Sagittal T1 weighted image shows the hypointense intramedullary lesion from C3 to T1.
So it's also extending over several segments.
Yes, less than.
It's more complicated appearance because hemorrhage is more common.
Yes.
Has cyst in adults.
Yes. Here in these two images, this is sagittal T2 and stair image, shows the lesion has three components. The segment from C6 to T1 is mildly hypertense, which corresponds to the area of contrast extending and represent the tumor component.
See the last image.
Yes.
About the last
image. Yes, here.
Yeah.
The segment of very hyperintense area above and below the image, this represent rings. And the ill-defined area represent edema. Hemangioblastoma is the third most common after ependymoma and astrocytoma. It's a tumor on the lining of blood vessels. This tumor is associated with von Hippel-Lindau syndrome. Imaging feature will be marked enhancement, cyst formation, and numerous flow voids because the tumor is vascular. Here, this is a lateral view of vertebral angiogram, show an enhancing vascular mass. And T1 post contrast show intensely a marked enhancement of the mass inside
one,
the cord. Yeah.
One spinal hemangioblastoma, just one spinal hemangioblastoma, is enough
no.
to diagnose von Hippel-Lindau.
No, we have three.
But in the brain, it's more than one, needs two, maybe three hemangioblastomas to diagnose
no.
von Hippel-Lindau. If you see one in the spine, it's enough.
You have to see multiple retinal angioma and visceral tumor, and sometimes hemangioblastoma
these
in the cerebellum.
These are the findings of von Hippel-Lindau.
Yes,
what are the
see.
Findings of von Hippel-Lindau? Is
these three
okay.
Yes.
However, if you see one spinal hemangioblastoma, you diagnose von Hippel-Lindau.
Yes, it's not like
okay.
the brain. Yes. Demyelinating lesion, an active multiple sclerosis lesion may mimic a spinal tumor, but it's distinguishable from a spinal tumor, but not causing significant mass effect and not cause cord expansion. There will be a hyperintense signal in T2 weighted image inside and not cause expansion, just the signal intensity will be changed. This also included in the differential diagnosis of intramedullary lesions. MS is the most common one. We have other one like transmitted myelitis and ADAM and so on. Intradural extramedullary, we have the most important here, nerve sheath tumors are the most common one. Schwannoma is more common, occur in older patient. It's difficult to differentiate between schwannoma and neurofibroma and radiographic imaging only. Schwannoma is more common in older adult patient and is encapsulated. While neurofibroma is associated with nephrofibromatosis type 1 and occur in younger patients than schwannoma. Both of them can cause neural foraminal enlargement. And target sign is seen in both conditions and suggests benignity, which is central hypointensity in T2 weight image. 15% of nerve sheath tumors are both intradural, extramedullary, and extradural, called dumbbell tumors. Intradural and extradural component. Like here, this is axial image.
And you can see the widening of
the neural
foramen.
Yes, both of them causes. Sagittal and axial T2 image reveals hyperintense mass at the level of C2 C3. In this axial image, we should see that causing widening of the neural foramina. This is post-contrast T1 image, fast suppressed, demonstrate that avidly enhancing mass. Meningioma is a benign neoplasm arising from arachnoid capsule cells. It's most commonly seen in older women. And the classic imaging finding is broad the dural base meningioma, often calcified. Typical location are anterior to the cord in the cervical spine and posterior to the cord in the thoracic spine. This is sagittal T2 weighted image and axial T1 post contrast shows an intradural exothoracic mass is distinct from the spinal cord, compressing the cord, widening the CSF space, and displacing the cord posteriorly. Here is show enhancement, yani marked enhancement, avidly enhancing. This was a meningioma in intradural extramedullary. Rare lesions here in this compartment, we have dermoid cysts, is a congenital lesion, usually present in childhood, contain microscopic pads that appear hyperintense in T1, weighted image. rarely may rupture cause fatal chemical meningitis.
Whenever you see something that has fat in it, it's a lymphoid. طبعا مو بس hyperintenson T1, should be hyperintenson T1 and hyperintenson T2 and suppresses on fat saturated. حتى تقول fat. ممكن hyperintenson T1 and
lymphoid. Maybe humorous, yes.
Okay, لازم hyperintenson T1 and T2 and suppresses on fat saturated. حتى تقول dermoid.
Yes. Epidermoid is a rare acquired spinal tumor that results from implantation of skin element in the subarachnoid space during neonatal lumbar puncture. Usually intradural extramedullary, but maybe rarely intramedullary. Most commonly appears as small cyst, low signal in T1, high signal in T2. Occasionally the cyst contain may be proteinaceous, causing T1 shortening and will be diffusion restricted. Mixopapillary ependymoma, it's an ependymoma variant that occurs exclusively in the lower cord or conus medullaris or filum terminale. The tumor is characterized by slow growing. Classically, there is scalloping of the vertebral body and spinal canal enlargement. It's highly vascular hemorrhagic tumor, feature complex MRI appearance. It's sagittal T2, sagittal T1. And post-contrast T1 show lobulated, complex lobulated mass hypointense in T1. This is located at the conus medullaris and enhancement. There are also enhancing leptomeningeal dissemination along the surface of the moroproximal cord here and along the cauda equina nerve roots. Arachnoiditis, inflammation of the arachnoid surrounding the nerve roots. It's classified, cause the displacement of the nerve root, classified into three groups. This is a normal nerve root. Central, either cause first group one, cause central conglomeration of the nerve root within the thecal sac, or peripheral clumping, group two, of the nerve root, cause empty thecal sac sign. All the nerve root may be conglomerate together, causing a mass like in the subarachnoid space. Group 3, obliteration of the subarachnoid space.
I think the first image is the normal one.
Yes, it's not normal. This is a peripheral image. Clumping.
Then this is peripheral clumping.
Yeah, empty cecal.
Yes,
the third
image is the obliteration.
Yes.
It's not the obliterated subarachnoid, it's just an empty fecal sac.
The nerve root will be appear like a soft tissue mass, not like normal nerve root.
The most common cause of arachnoiditis?
Nowadays surgery. Before
surgery and trauma.
Previously it was myelography.
Extradural lesion, most important, we have degenerative spine, osteophyte and herniated disc. Are the most common extradural that we talk about them, inshallah. Vertebral body epidural metastasis. Metastasis is the most common adult extradural malignancy. Breast, lung, and prostate are the most common primary tumor to metastasize to the spinal column. T1 and stair image will be best to evaluate of spinal tumors because of fat hyperintense on T1 and the lesion, the tumor metastasis will cause focal area of decreased intensity on T1 iterated image. Diffuse decrease in T1 is non-specific, also it's abnormal. We have another differential diagnosis of diffuse decrease, like lymphoma, leukemia, myelofibrosis, and so on. We have also infection, discitis, osteomyelitis, infection epidural collection, and we have primary extradural tumor, which is rare. Hemangioma is an extradural lesion. It's more common, usually instead of found benign lesion. Cause striated cordory appearance and polka dot signs on axial and striated cordory appearance on sagittal CT scan because of resorption of some of the trabeculae and thickening of the remaining one. And on MRI appears hyperintense in both T1 and T2. We have a variant that may be appear hypointense in T1 and hyperintense in T2. And this is, yes, was difficult to differentiate from metastasis, especially in those who have primary. And we have aggressive variant that involve all the parts we extend to the spinal canal. Primary osseous vertebral body tumor We have classified to for middle age and older adult, and for young adult and adolescent. This for older age, we have chordoma, which is a lytic expansile lesion midline, arise from notochord remnant, enhancing mass. About 15% occur in the vertebral column. We have plus mastocytoma also, it's a lytic solitary expansile lesion as a precursor of multiple myeloma occur in older age groups. We have chondrosarcoma also, it's a low grade malignancy but hyper intense on T2, containing RIG and ARC calcification. Yes, because of calcification. This, we have no time to talk about the one bone by one picture. Aneurysmal bone cyst, 20% occur in the posterior element, especially vertebral column. Will be show multiple MRI is the imaging investigation of choice, show multiple air fluid levels, and seeing young adolescent. Chondroblastoma also it's, occur, but rarely occur in the posterior element also. Osteoid osteoma is a sclerotic lesion composed of central radiolucent nidus with central calcification and surrounded by sclerosis. Imaged by the clinical feature, nocturnal pain relieved by non-steroid anti-inflammatory drug, and will take the on radioisotope scan. Will take the osteosarcoma. Also, it's an aggressive malignancy that show matrix calcification. These are the tumor that we have. Another one also arise, but these are more common, like Ewing sarcoma also. Yes. We have epidural lipomatosis. It's a rare overgrowth of fat in extradural space. In severe cases, epidural lipomatosis can cause neural foramen stenosis, may cause Calde equina syndrome. It's caused by exogenous steroid or maybe a complication of morbid obesity. We have disc bulge and herniated degenerative diseases. The normal intervertebral disc, we know that's composed of central nucleus pulposus and peripheral peripheral annulus fibrosis. Disc bulge or herniation occur when the substance of the disc, nucleus pulposus and annulus fibrosus, or both of them, extend beyond the normal disc margin. With aging, disc tend to become degenerated, manifested as 2T2 shortening and decreased signal intensity in T2. Loss of disc space height may affect multiple levels. Osteophyte can project anteriorly or posteriorly in the cervical spine. Anterior osteophyte may cause dysphagia. Anywhere in the spine, posteriorly projecting osteophyte may contribute to spinal canal or neural foraminal stenosis. Smaller knot is also represent inferior or superior in herniation of intervertebral discs into the adjacent vertebral body in plate that cause a bony defect in these in plates. An acute smaller node may be hyper intense on T2 image. Normally it's hypo intense, but maybe hyper intense. Abnormal lumbar disc, we have bulge, we have herniation. Bulge may be circumference, bulge means more than extending of the disc margin beyond the normal line, more than 25%. Maybe circumferential, symmetrical, or not circumferential, asymmetrical. Herniation means either protrusion or extrusion. Protrusion, the neck or the base is more than the dome. While in extrusion, the dome is more than the base, yani the neck is narrow. Once protruded, disc material may separate from its parent disc to become sequestrated fragment, which may migrate superiorly or inferiorly. You have a site of disc to divide the site of disc herniation. We have central, paracentral, or subarticular. Some say foraminal is subarticular, and extraforaminal. This is a descending nerve root, and this is the exiting nerve root. Neural foramina here, and this is a facet joint. Nerve root. At the level of thoracic and lumbar, each exiting nerve root will extend, will come below the corresponding vertebral level, while in the cervical, extend above the corresponding vertebral level. For example, in L4, L5, this L4 nerve root will be impinged by far lateral or foraminal disc herniation. While in L4, L5, L5 disc nerve root, the descending nerve root will be impinged by central or paracentral disc herniation. This is a normal, this is protrusion and may migrate and may sequestrate and detach from the sparing disc. We have vertebral body change, in plate changes, modic change. It means that degenerative change in the spine that are associated with vertebral body in plate and subchondral marrow signal chain, classified by modic into three types. Type 1, hypointense in T2, hyperintense in T2, hypointense in T1, indicate inflammatory change and edema. Type 2 is hyperintense in both T1 and T2, is indicate marrow fatty proliferation due to marrow ischemia, and type 3 is low signal in both, one indicates sclerosis. This type, first type 1, will cause active symptom. These two types not cause any active symptom as usual, like low back pain and so on. We have facet joint. The intervertebral facet joint are synovial joint as large other large joints, so undergo degenerative changes like cartilage loss, subchondral sclerosis, and so on. These facet joints are located medial to the neural foramina. Degenerative change of the facet joint may cause neural foraminal narrowing. In ligamentum flavum hypertrophy, ligamentum flavum lines the lamina at the posterior aspect of the spinal canal. In a sagittal image, we see dots like that, not like the thickening appear here. Here, thickened, and here we see easily and clearly. The axial image. This also may contribute to spinal neural foramina and spinal canal narrowing sometimes. Synovial cyst we have is an epidural cyst that is associated with facet arthropathy. Here is associated with facet joint arthropathy. We have other cysts called Tarlov cyst. It's epineural cyst of sacrum formed within the nerve. Epineural, yes.
Perineural,
yes. Of the sacrum, formed within the nerve root sheath. And usually it's asymptomatic. I think this one is a synovial cyst. So. Non-degenerative hypertrophic diseases, we have diffuse idiopathic skeletal hyperosteosis. This is a flowing anterior osteophyte extending at least four vertebral body levels. There is preservation of the disc space, may predispose to spinal fracture because of spinal column immobility and associated with ossification of posterior longitudinal ligament. The flowing osteophyte will be appear here and associated with ossification of posterior longitudinal ligament in C-T1. Ossification of the posterior longitudinal ligament is calcification and ossification, which may lead to spinal canal stenosis and compression of the anterior.
What? I saw upside down.
What?
I saw upside down.
I see three images together. I copy like.
Upside down.
Skull superior. Yeah, this is anterior and extended, cause compression of the anterior aspect of the cord. Usually began in the cervical spine, but may extend inferiorly to the thoracic spine. We have postoperative spine. Usually use contrast in case of infection and postoperative spine to distinguish between recurrent disc and scar tissue. Both disc and scar tissue appear hypointense on T2 weighted image MRI. In the theory, the scar tissue should enhance thorough out, while recurrent disc demonstrate only peripheral enhancement. This is recurrent disc. While scar tissue might enhance thaw out.
Can I sell in scar or this question?
How the scar, dancing, taking
it. No, this is sort of enhancement. Do that contrast?
This is peripheral.
So, tumor enhancement, diffuse or peripheral?
Diffuse. Most.
Why not, you know?
Scar, not the scar.
We have infection, discitis, or osteomyelitis, or spondylodiscitis. It involves the disc and the vertebral body. It's caused by bacterial infection of the intervertebral disc and the body, and adjacent vertebral body. Staphylococcus is the most common. We have other like Strepsiphilus, Escherichia coli, and so on. In adult, the vascularized subchondral bone is the initial site of infection, while in children, the intervertebral disc is initially infected. The key imaging appearance of discoids or osteomyelitis is marrow hyperintensity on T1, and hyperintense in T2 as indicate edema. And loss of adjacent in-plane definition is usually present. On radiograph, the only initial clue is loss of disc space height. And there may be soft tissue, paraspinal, soft tissue, epidural abscess, and so on, like that. The sagittal CT and T1 and T2 image show pyogenic discoids, osteomyelitis. Sagittal CT show loss of disc space height. There are several degenerative changes also we have here. And T1 image, middle image, show diffuse marrow hypointensity with the replacement with hypointense marrow signal in these two affected vertebrae and discs also, with loss of definition of the end plates. T2 MRI show hyperintensity in the affected disc. And cord compression with is the cord is compressed with signal chain inside the cord. Yes.
It's very important to see the TB spondylitis affect more than one level.
Yes, multiple level, skin lesions.
Yes. While the pyogenic affect the lumbar.
Yes.
And involve about 1 to 2 vertebrae.
Yes, skin lesion we have in TB, multiple level, and more paraspinal abs.
More prominent of the TB.
Yes, with calcification in TB sometimes. But I don't know where is the slide of TB. I mentioned here. With this TB also more cause acute angled kyphosis. I don't know where. Maybe before. Okay.
Also brucellosis.
Yes, we have brucellosis and here we have no time to mention. Vascular dural arteriovenous fistula is the most common spinal vascular malformation. It typically affected older males with back pain and progressive myelopathy. We have five types of Cognar classification. Spinal dural arteriovenous is a type 5 because only in type 5 we have spinal dural venous trench. MRI of dural arteriovenous fistula show flow void surrounding the cord. Here we see flow with loss of signal surrounding the cord. And the cord must be swelling, edematous, with abnormal intramedullary T2 prolongation. CT myelography show a serpiginous filling defect in the subarachnoid space. We have spinal cord infarction is most common in upper thoracic or thoracolumbar spine. Imaging of spinal cord infarction also show hyperintensity of the affected cord region in T2 weighted image. Here we have in this image, axial T2 image, MRI shows a symmetrical hyperintense signal in the ventral horn of the intramedullary gray matter and will be restricted on diffusion. We have congenital lesion, tethered cord syndrome, means spinal cord is tethered or attached to the surrounding tissue. It's a clinical syndrome of back pain and leg pain, gait spasticity, and decreased lower extremity sensation. Normally, the cone should terminate superior to the inferior end plate of L2. If terminate below this level, the cord may be tethered. Or the cord may be tethered by signet phylum or lipoma also. Diastomatomelia is a congenital split spinal cord, which may be a cause of scoliosis. This coronal T2 MRI shows CSF cleft between the two hemichords. And in this axial image T2, show the two hemichord with a single CSF space.
One can be with a single dural sac, each with separate dural sac, two dural sacs, and you look for a fibrous or bony spur that divides the cord into two cords. Diamond, fibrous, low bony spur.
Any bony spur, any congenital, you mean?
Yeah, congenital. السيبوني اللي تشوفيه بالسي تي والفايبرس تلاقيه احسن من الام ار اي.
فاتي فيلم بس فاتي من الساجيتال تي 1 ام ار اي شو هايبرتينس ان ذا فيلم represent fat in the film terminally. This fat in the film may be associated with diastomatomilia or T3rd cord. T1. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Good job and nice presentation. Any comments, any questions, notes?